Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hid their faces. Spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured, while we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes, we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shears, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Please use the pamphlets for the Passion and take the part of the crowd C. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him, He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. And when he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
Jesus
answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you're looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. it was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. When the maid, who was the gate, then the maid who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter, he said,
I am not.
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made, because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there, keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area, where all the Jews gather, and in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
Is this the way you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered him,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
You are not one of his disciples, are you?
He denied it and said,
I am not.
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said, Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
What charge do you bring against this man?
They answered and said to him,
If you were not a criminal, we would not have handed over to you.
At this, Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law.
The Jews answered him,
We do not have the right to execute anyone.
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?
Pilate answered,
I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief of priests handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
So Pilate said to him,
Then you are a king?
Jesus answered,
You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
They cried out again,
Now
Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
Hail, King of the
and they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And Pilate said to them,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and I have the power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him at the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon, and he said to the Jews,
"Behold, your king."
They cried out,
"Take him away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another, in order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots." This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the Spirit. Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths, along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they lay Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the very first chapter of the Gospel of John, when the adult Jesus appears for the first time, John the baptizer by the Jordan, says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And the next day, Jesus is there with a few of John's other disciples, and John says the same thing, "Behold the Lamb of God." Throughout the scriptures, Jesus is often referred to as this sacrificial lamb, the lamb that is slain, slaughtered for the Passover meal every year. And there was something about that image of the innocent, lovely, one-year-old lamb being slaughtered for the Passover meal that reminded them, the writers, the early church, of Jesus himself. The Passover lamb was slain and the blood put on the doorposts for the Hebrew people the very first time in Egypt. And the angel of death passed over those homes, and the firstborn was not killed there. And then that was the instructions that are given again and again in Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers about preparing the Passover lamb every year, to remind them that the Passover lamb was a means of their salvation, of their being rescued from Egypt. Throughout the scriptures, there are all these references to lamb and sheep, too many to begin to mention, but in the Psalms, in Isaiah, the reading we had, like a lamb led to the slaughter, like a sheep silent before the shearers. Isaiah is talking about the suffering servant of God, and the scripture writers later, the gospel writers, saw images of Jesus in all of that. Two of the gospels, when they talk about the disciples being sent off to prepare for the Passover dinner, mention that it's the Feast of Unleavened Bread, that is the Passover, the day when the Passover lamb was slaughtered. As if people didn't get the connection, they remind them, Mark and Luke, that the Passover lamb is going to be slaughtered, the lamb for the meal, but also referring to Jesus, the ultimate Passover lamb that will be killed. And one reason I think that there's all this attention to the lamb and the sheep is because crucifixion was such a terrible death, was such an agonizing, torturous death, that the gospel writers really don't concentrate on it in any detail. They prefer other images. When the gospel writers say that Jesus, the soldiers, crucified Jesus, they just pretty much use four words. They crucified him there. And they don't even make that a sentence. That's buried in a sentence of another 12 or 15 or 20 some words about dividing the garments or the thieves, the criminals on each side. They really knew how terrible crucifixion was. They really didn't want to describe it in any detail. And so we have all these images of the lamb and sheep. When it comes to the sheep, we're usually the sheep that have wandered away. That's most often the way the general term is used for the sheep. The good news of this, the reason we call this Good Friday, is that the crucifixion of Jesus is good news for our world. The cross is an ugly sign of a torturous death, but it's also the sign of the Father's great love, his infinite merciful kindness to us sinners on earth. This is God reaching out to gather all the people of earth to himself, to reconcile. This loving God sent the beloved Son into the world to live among us, to bring us back to our God. And so Jesus spent his life healing, uniting people, teaching, forgiving, uniting people in faith and prayer, and trying to help them understand the overwhelming love of God for them. On this day, Christians throughout the world gather to reflect on the cross. In the shadow of the cross, at the foot of the lamb that was slaughtered, we have no explanations. We really can't describe and explain and have it all make sense, except through the eyes of a loving God who embraces all of his people. And so in our liturgy, at the foot of the cross, in the shadow of the lamb that was slaughtered, all we can do is pray. And that's the next part of our liturgy. In our masses, we have a few intercessions, but on this day, we have a very formal, long list of intercessions for the whole church, the universal prayer, because that's all we can do at the foot of the cross, is simply humbly pray to the loving Father who gathers us.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty, ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you their Maker,
may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray also for our Bishop Wolkowiak, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty, ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty, ever-living God, who make your Church ever faithful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth to gather them together and keep them in his one Church.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty, ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty, ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mysteries of life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right with sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God Himself.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty, ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always, by desiring you and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty, ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, Look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty, ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because in the hour of your need, your mercy was at hand. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for a swift end to the coronavirus pandemic that afflicts our world, that our God and Father will heal the sick, strengthen those who care for them, and help us all to persevere in faith.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and merciful God, source of all life and health and healing, look with compassion on our world, brought lowly by disease. Protect us in the midst of the grave challenges that assail us, and in your fatherly providence, grant recovery to the stricken. Strengthen those who care for them, and success to those working to eradicate this scourge. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world. Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Please stand. At the Savior's command, informed by the word of God, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Please kneel. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty ever living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please bow your heads. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure through Christ our Lord.